Thank you. Well, good morning. Would like to welcome you here to First Presbyterian Church in beautiful Huntsville, Tennessee, in the heart of Scott County, where we always say, you are welcome here and we mean it. So we are happy you are joining us today. Would like to extend special thanks to Beth, to Michelle Ayers, to Philip, who is running our sound system today, and for all of those who are making our worship possible. So we are very appreciative of this. We are still continuing with our Christmas card drop-offs, so if you need to pick up extra cards or if you need to drop them off, just let us know here at the office and we will be happy to facilitate you doing so. Our online giving is set up through firstpreshuntsville.org, and so you can do that through our online giving, or you can send those here to P.O. Box 39 in Huntsville, Tennessee, to continue your giving to the congregation in the work and mission of the church. Want to welcome you into worship. Welcome you with all the love and warmth of the house of God for the people of God. Let us now come into a time of worship. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we call upon you today to enter with us in worship. Where two or three are gathered together, you are near. And so we ask, O God, that you be with us as we read your word, as we worship together, as we lift the music up to heaven. We ask, O God, that you watch over us, you care for us, and you nurture us as we go. Deep breaths in and out, celebrating another day of life. We ask, O God, that you watch over and nurture us and lead us into this worship. Amen. Who is the great niece of Lowell and Alice, Dr. Gary Phillips, Isaac King, Bob Smith, Todd and Jody, Miranda Keaton, and Akia, Liz's sister. Let us now pray together. Gracious and loving God, we ask, O Lord, that you watch over all of those listed here, all of those on our church prayer list, all of those serving our community, our nation, and our world. We ask, O God, to open our hearts, for we know for as many prayers are spoken today, you know our hearts. You know every thought before we think it, and every word we speak before it crosses our lips. So we ask, O God, that you hear all of those unspoken prayers, that you lift them on the wings of angels into the world, that our energies and prayers may go forth, that bodies, minds, and spirits will feel calm, peace, and healing that only you, O God, can offer. And we come now to pray humbly as you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And so now we come to the time for our children's message. So as we said last week, we're not bouncing down the stairs to do that. And I wish you were all here with us so that we could. But I know you're watching at home. So what I want to talk to you about today is something that we see a lot of here in Scott County, and that's storms. And so we see thunder and lightning and high winds, and sometimes trees come down, and it gets pretty scary. And so what we're talking about today in our sermon and in our readings is about how sometimes we have to step out into a storm to do something that's a little scary, but that we know that in doing so, that Jesus is always right there with us, just like moms and dads and big brothers and cousins, to pick us up and to put us back on safe ground if we fall. So this morning, that is our message about how the storms come, but how when we cry out to Jesus, all will be well. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, thank you for the little children. Thank you for the light that they bring into our lives and the lessons they teach us on a daily basis. We ask, O God, that you will let us come to you as little children, that you will open our hearts and our minds for the reading of your word. Help us to find your message that you are speaking to us today, that we might be better servants, that we might live more into the call that you place on each of our lives. For it is in your name we pray. Amen. Our first reading this morning comes to us from Genesis. Genesis 37, 1 through 4, and then 12 through 28. This is Joseph. Joseph being sold into slavery in Egypt. Our Old Testament and our Psalms this morning follows the story of Joseph. Jacob settled in the land where his father had lived as an alien, in the land of Canaan. This is the story of the family of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was shepherding the flock with his brothers. He was a helper to the sons of Bahal and Zephah, his father's wives, and Joseph brought a bad report to them, to their father. Now Israel loved Joseph more than any other of his children, because he was the son of his old age, and he had made him a long robe with sleeves. But when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not speak peaceably to him. Now his brothers went to the pastures, their father's flock, near Shechem. And Israel said to Joseph, "Are not your brothers pasturing the flock at Shechem? Come, I will send you to them." And he answered, "Here I am." So he said to him, "Go, see if it is well with your brothers and with the flock, and bring word back to me." So he sent him from the valley of Hebron, and he came to Shechem, and a man found him wandering in the fields. And the man asked him, "What are you seeking?" "I am seeking my brothers," he said. "Tell me, please, where are they pasturing the flock?" And the man said, "They have gone away, for I heard them say, 'Let us go to Dothan.'" So Joseph went after his brothers and found them at Dothan. They saw him from a distance, and before he came near to them, they conspired to kill him. They said to one another, "Here comes this dreamer. Come now, let us kill him and throw him into one of the pits. Then we shall say that a wild animal has devoured him, and we shall see what will become of his dreams." But when Reuben heard it, he delivered him out of the hand, saying, "Let us not take his life." Reuben said to them, "Shed no blood. Throw him into the pit here in the wilderness, but lay no hand on him, so that he might rescue him out of the hand and restore him to his father." So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robes, the long robe with its sleeves that he wore, and they took him and threw him into the pit. The pit was empty. There was no water in it. Then they sat down and ate, and looked up. They saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Galilee with their camels carrying gum, balm, and resin on their way to carry it down to Egypt. Then Judah said to his brothers, "What profit is it if we kill our brother and conceal his blood? Come, let us sell him to the Ishmaelites and not lay our hands on him, for he is our brother, our own flesh." And his brothers agreed. Well, when some Midianites traders passed by, they drew Joseph up, lifting him out of the pit, and sold him to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver. And they took Joseph to Egypt. Our psalm reading is also on Joseph this morning. Psalm 105, verses 1 through 6, and then 16 through 22. Oh, give thanks to the Lord and call his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him. Sing praises to him. Tell of all his wonderful work. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his presence continually. Remember the wonderful works he has done, this miracle and the judgments he has uttered. O offspring of his servant Israel, children of Jacob, his chosen ones. And when he summoned famine against the land and broke every staff of bread, he sent a man ahead of them, Joseph, who was sold as a slave. His feet were hurt with fetters. His neck was put in a collar of iron. Until what he had said came to pass, and the word of the Lord kept testing him. The king sent and released him. The ruler of the people set him free, made him the lord of his house and the ruler of all his possessions, to instruct his officials at his pleasure and to teach his elders wisdom. Praise the Lord. Holy wisdom, holy word. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
New Testament reading this morning is from Romans chapter 10, verses 5 through 15. Listen now for the words of the Lord. Moses writes concerning the righteous that comes from the law, that the person who does these things will live by them. But the righteous that comes by faith says, "Do not say it in your heart, who will ascend to heaven, that is to bring Christ down, or who will descend into the abyss, that is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart, and so is justified, and one confesses with the mouth, and so is saved. The scripture says, no one who believes in him will be put to shame, for there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is the Lord of all, and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But how are they to call on the one in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in the one whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone to proclaim him? And how are they to proclaim him unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet for those who bring the good news. We pick up this week in our Matthew reading, Matthew 14, verses 22 to 33, right where we left off. They have just fed the 5,000 plus the women and children. And immediately, Jesus makes the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up to the mountain by himself to pray. And when evening came, he was there alone. But by this time, the boat, battered by the waves, was far from land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, he walking towards them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "Is it a ghost?" And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." And he said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came towards Jesus. But when he noticed the strong wind, he became frightened, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" And when they got to the boat, the wind ceased. And those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, truly, you are the Son of God." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. He said, "Come. Come to me." The thing that kept talking to me this week when working with the scripture for this morning was the motion. The motion found in our readings. All four of our readings this morning deal with a forward motion. In Genesis, it's Jacob who sends Joseph to his brothers. The brothers sell him to the Midianites and traders. And then they take him to Egypt in a forward motion that leads us into our psalm reading, which continues the story of Joseph, who has been sold as a slave. His feet are in fetters and has a collar of iron around his neck, about as bad as it can get. But Joseph is a dreamer of dreams. And when his dreams came to pass, the king released him. By the end of our reading, Joseph is the head of the king's household and was in charge of all that he had and was able to instruct the king's officials and teach the elders his wisdom. All forward motion, moving forward as we go. Our reading from Romans tells us that the word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. And it asks us, how are those who have not heard to believe? And how are they to hear without someone to proclaim him unless they're sent? The reading ends with even more action. How beautiful are the feet of those who bring the good news. So by the time that we get to our gospel readings this morning, we are surrounded by motion. Much like the motion found in our readings from the gospel that we've been working our way through. Working our way through the gospel readings this liturgical year. Moving forward in the year through the book of Matthew. Joseph and his disciples have just fed 5,000 men, plus all the women and children that would have been with him. And Jesus at this point is telling his disciples to get in the boat and go ahead of him. While Jesus dismisses the crowd. So the disciples are sent ahead, the crowds are sent away, and Jesus goes up to the mountain to pray. Sent ahead, sent away, goes up. All forward going motions. It should not be lost on those of us who were studying last week that Jesus went ahead in the boat to pray, but he had compassion on the crowds there on the bank. He healed their sick and saw that they were fed before he dismissed them. The disciples find themselves on stormy water with strong winds and waves, and it just makes some of us dizzy thinking about it, of being on a boat and envisioning what it must be like to be in a storm. These are all motions. Now imagine, if you will, being in that boat and seeing someone walking towards you on the water, in the midst of a storm, no less. Well, that's got to be jarring. In fact, the scripture tells us it was terrifying. And they screamed out, "Is this a ghost?" But Jesus spoke and said, "Take heart. It is I. Do not be afraid." Words echoed to us from the Old Testament to the New Testament. Do not be afraid. So what does Peter do? Well, Peter calls out, "If it is you, command me to come to you." And Jesus says, "Come." He said, "Come. Get out of that boat and come to me." So Peter does. And he walks to Jesus. More forward motion. This time, he stepped out of safety. Out of the certainty of a boat surrounded by people and into the storm because he said, "Come." Peter, see, walked into stormy waters. This was not a peaceful pond, something out of a storybook. No, this was a storm. The winds, the waves, all of it. He walked following Jesus. And when the winds came, Peter was frightened, and he started to sink. But even in his sinking, he cried out, "Lord, save me." And Jesus stuck his hand out, and he caught Peter, saying, "You of little faith, why do you doubt?" Not scolding him, but questioning him. "Why do you doubt?" Jesus and Peter went to the boat to safety, and the winds ceased. And those in the boat worshiped Jesus, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." forward motion for the disciples who in that moment, their eyes are clear. They worship, saying, truly, you are the Son of God. There's a lot of motion in our reading. People coming and going. People being sent places and moving around, all around the central figure, Jesus. Now, when Jesus walked onto the water, the disciples were unsure of what they were seeing. It took Peter. Peter, being brave enough to call out to Jesus and saying, hey, if it's you. And Jesus saying, come to me. In the midst of a storm, Peter had to take a physical step outside of that boat, outside of his comfort zone, and to do what only Peter could do. He stepped out, and the other disciples bore witness to Peter. They bore witness to Peter getting out of that boat. They bore witness to fear and doubt, but above all, they bore witness to Jesus reaching out his hand and bringing Peter to safety, delivering him safely back to the boat and calming that storm. Motion and action. We're all like Peter in some ways. Maybe it's not in a boat during a storm, but we all have our own Peter moments. Perhaps you're having a major life change, deciding how to educate your children in the fall, deciding when it will be okay to visit friends again, looking at a family situation or change or any other day-to-day decision that offers fear and anxiety. And Jesus said, come to me. Step out of the safety of that normal day today and step into something a little different. Change what you can, take risks, and get comfortable with being uncomfortable. So in the spring of my senior year of seminary, I had the privilege of taking a class down the street at the Episcopal Seminary in the Southwest. And it was titled, Spirituality in the Workplace. Now when I saw that in the offering, I was like, wow, what is this? Because I, like a lot of you, spent my adult life in corporate America, where you absolutely 100% do not talk about spirituality in the workplace. Any kind. So when I saw this class offering, I was like, sign me up. I want to know what they're teaching in that class. And for me, it was kind of a Peter moment. A time when I had to take all that my business degree, those 15 years of business had taught me, and throw it out the window. Go to a seminary I'd never been to, in a class with people I didn't know, and learn about something that I wasn't quite sure I was okay with or even knew what it was going to be about. It was an interesting change because the class was made of seminary students from several denominations. There were social workers and chaplaincy students, several from nonprofits and tech fields, all in Austin, Texas, which in itself is different in a lot of ways for most of us. And we were going to spend a whole semester studying and talking about how you could talk about spirituality in the workplace. Okay. So this is amazing because what it taught us was that even in the most rigid corporate setting, we're never actually removed from spirituality in the workplace. Because people of faith, well, we're just that. We're people of faith. And the world may want to change our language around how we talk about faith, but our actions and how we move in the world speak much louder than any HR handbook can. People of faith are people of faith. We always are, and we always will be. When Jesus says, come to me, Peter took what he knew, that we most certainly could not walk on water, and he tossed it aside, and he said, well, I'm getting out of this boat. Sure, he had fear, and when fear took over, he started to sink. But in doing so, he cried out. He cried out to Jesus, and Jesus picked him up right where he was at and put him back in the boat and calmed those seas. You see, if you find yourself in a situation to make a difference in someone's day-to-day, that might be offering words of encouragement after a business meeting, picking up the phone, calling a friend that you've noticed, maybe is posting stuff that's a little sad on Facebook, but you just got that feeling that you've got to call them, that you're checking on an elderly neighbor, that you're picking up a phone and calling a local school and saying, hey, is there anything you need? Did you get all the cleaning supplies and things that you need for the year? Is there anything I can do? So those are big things and little things. Sometimes it's something as simple as hearing somebody getting beat with words of negativity from around them and simply stopping by a cubicle and saying, hey, it's going to be okay today. I want you to know I see you. I hear you. That you are heard, that you are valued, and that you make a difference to me. So yeah, sometimes language is restricting because of the settings that we often find ourselves in. But there's no restrictions on being kind, giving a thumbs up when you have your mask on, or a smile when you have it off, from a safe social distance. Stepping out of your comfort zone to be kind and share the love and light of Christ with the world can be pretty nerve-wracking, but it can also be life-giving. The disciples witnessed Peter getting out of that boat and Jesus picking him up and calming the storms, and it was this witness that caused them to worship Jesus, saying, truly, truly, this is the Son of God. Because sometimes actions speak louder than words. They didn't necessarily hear the interaction with Peter and Jesus, but they saw that motion. They saw Peter saying, hey, he said, come to me, I'm going, I'm getting out of this boat. They saw him going under and they saw Jesus bring him right back to safety. Actions speak louder than words. And when Christ says, come to me, you have to step out of your comfort zone and make a difference in the world. You can make a difference through the witness of Jesus Christ just by the actions you take in the world that you move in. Without a single word, you might be able to change the life of another. You might be able to be the one person that person looks up and goes, I see them as a good person. I want what they've got. And maybe that's a, hey, who is that Jesus guy? What's he done in your life? Getting out of that comfort zone. Saying that just because someone else's rules tell you that you can't say this or that in any setting, you can always be kind. You can always take the light of Christ into the world. Because Jesus will calm those stormy waters. Jesus will pick you up because we are called to be the action of Christ in the world, to be the ones who go out and share the good news that no matter how those stormy waters get, no matter how scary, if you just take those steps, when Christ says, come to me, and you get out and you take the risk, even if you start to falter, and we will all doubt, and we will all falter, because we are beautifully made, and we all fall short. But at the end of the day, Jesus says, come to me. Put your faith in God. Step out of that boat and listen for those words. Come to me. And then maybe the next step that you take Well, being those feet that go out into the world, to share the good news of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. All thanks and glory be to God. Amen. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we come to you in prayer today for our entire community of Scott County, as well as our nation and our world. Lord, we pray that you help us to heal as a community from this virus. We pray for the healing and comfort of those who are sick and fearful. We pray that you take their anxieties and sickness away. And we also pray for their loved ones who are taking care of them or hoping to see them recover. Please take their worries, Lord. We pray for our students, teachers, staff, and faculty as they head into a new school year. Lord, we know that they are very fearful and want to remain healthy. We pray that you wrap them in a blanket of safety and protect them from this virus. We pray for the parents sending their children to school. You know their worry, Lord. Please protect our school systems. Lord, we pray for our healthcare workers. They put others before themselves every day and push all of their worries aside for the health of our citizens. We are so thankful for them, and our prayer is that you shelter them from this virus. We also extend a prayer for the health and protection of all of those in the workforce. This prayer feels like asking to move a mountain right now, but we know it can be done through you, Lord. We pray for the healing of our county, state, nation, and world. We pray that this virus will no longer spread and cases will decline. We pray for our children, mothers, fathers, elderly, families, individuals, workers, churches, and our leaders. We pray for our community. We pray for your will. We pray that we can feel safe and enjoy time with our loved ones again. We know that you hear our prayers, and we thank you. In your name we pray. Amen.
The candles are lit. We will hold these prayers. May God, our Creator, watch over you. May we walk and step outside of that boat, listening to those words of Jesus saying, "Come to me." And may the Holy Spirit hold you as you bravely step into the call on your life given by God, saying, "Come to me." In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.